During the past few days, I'm sure you have learned many theories, many investment techniques. Now, I think it's time to apply some of the theories and tools you learned to some real problems. So today, I'm going to offer one real question. It's about real estate markets. And also, I guess some of you may be tired after these 4 days of very intense learning. So I'm trying my best to make my lecture as simple and as interesting as possible. If you have any questions, just feel free to interrupt. And if you don't have questions, I probably will ask you some questions. Okay, so these are the contents I'm going to cover. First, I will give you a brief introduction what the business and labor market information economist means. Then I will briefly summarize the economic indication and also the empirical evidence in the literature. And then I will focus on the course of application strategies if you want to do your research in this area using micro-level data. And you will find that some of the theories and also information tools we have learned in these days can be applied here. And in the end, I will discuss a list of your research topics, and some of which may be developed into your research project by yourself. And if we have more time, I will present one or two of my research studies in this area. So, in order to understand the land by the agglomeration economies, we need first to understand what a business the agglomeration economies is. But in order to understand the business, the agglomeration economies, we need to understand the cities. So, in this world, 50% of the population actually lives in urban areas of cities. In China, also about 50% of the population lives in the cities. So, what is a city? So, a simple definition is that a city is a place with very high population density. Different countries have different definitions about the threshold of population density, but I'm not going to go over those definitions. So, the best idea is that a city is a place with a high concentration of people, so the population density is very high compared with rural areas. So, during the past few days, many professors emphasized it's very important to ask a good questions. So, here is one example. This is a very good question. So, why do we have cities? Why do cities exist? So, many people live in cities, so probably you never thought about this question. But this question actually, the answer to this question actually is probably a half part of the whole world urban economics. If you recall the economics principle, the marginal cost of marginal benefit analysis, actually it turns out the answer is very simple. So by definition, cities is an area with a high concentration of people and firms and businesses. So why do cities exist? There must be some benefit when people co-locate together. So if we can clearly identify those benefits, then we can understand the incentive for people and for firms to co-locate together. Of course, there are also some costs associated with the concentration of people and economic activities. The costs including like congestion, pollution, high land rates, high housing prices. But in this topic, I only covered the benefit side. I will not cover the cost side. So, simply speaking, the benefit from the concentration. Basically, the benefits from the concentration of people in cities is generally called the agglomeration economies. So which put a very very vague words, agglomeration wants to call all the benefits associated with the concentration or high density relation. So for business agglomeration economies, by definition, it's the benefit from the concentration of firms in the limited geographic areas. Okay. In the literature, as earlier as in the decade in 1937, a very famous regional economist over in his book, he defined the concept of the agglomeration economies. He classified this benefit into two types. One is called localization economies. Basically, it means a firm can benefit from the concentration of other firms which are in the same industry in the same city. A good example is Silicon Valley in California and also Chongqing. It's a cluster for computer industries. So think about this question. Suppose you want to start a computer firm. You have three location choices. You can choose to locate in Chongqing or choose to locate your firm in the financial district and also in the shopping mall area in the downtown. Which location would you like to choose? Chongqing, and why? There are many benefits which I will discuss with you soon. Correspondingly, a firm can benefit from the concentration of other industry firms in the same city. That means, suppose you want to start a computer firm. So you have a few choices across different cities. Okay? Let's say one city is Beijing, one city is, maybe Archie. It's specialized in oil industry. Another place is like Panjiahua, is specialized in steel industry. So which location would you like to choose? Probably big cities like Beijing, Shanghai, or Guangzhou. Why? Because a computer industry is a high tech industry. A high tech industry needs a lot of face to face communication to create new ideas, new knowledge. So if you choose in a location with a lot of different industries, a lot of different people with different skills, the chances are very high to come up with better ideas, better ways to invent new products. But if you choose to locate in a very specialized industry, because everything is so specialized, you cannot get much benefits from other different sources. So basically, localization economies means firms can benefit from specialization. And urbanization economies means firms can benefit from diversity of the city. It's very interesting to note that even though this concept was invented probably 100 years ago, but urban economists still adopted these two classifications. There is not much progress in terms of understanding the benefits of cities. So if you can come up with a better idea, you can find out the third types of benefits, then you will make a very important contribution to urban economics. So what kind of channels, mechanisms that can generate such kind of benefits? Urban economists have constructed many theories, models to explain the micro foundations of the benefits. In terms of localization economies, economists that like to use the words sharing, pooling, and learning to explain the micro foundations. But I want to add two more channels. I don't want to go over theories because those theories are very model specific. I already give you a list of references if you you are interested, you can pursue that course. But I want to go with the economic introductions. The first channel is so-called input sharing. Okay. Suppose each firm co-located in the city, they need the same inputs. But if the inputs, if the production technology of the inputs requires increasing or increasing scale or requires scale economies, that means to lower the average cost of the inputs, then the demand for the input should be very large. So basically, if the inputs production involves scale economies, then it's better for many firms co-located in the same place. So the demand for the inputs will be large, so the average cost of the inputs will be very low. Okay? So such kind of examples are many, like infrastructures, like highway, airports, power plants. Some business services also have increased business scale. For example, like a law firm. In a small city, you may maybe encounter. The number of clients probably are not enough to support one bigger law firm, but in big cities, since there are many firms, the demand for all kinds of legal services. Another example would be like an opera house. Even though it's a consumption goods, but to support one opera house, it requires a huge population. In China, and in Shanghai, there are opera houses, but in my city, there is no opera house. So you can see how important this house is. So the second channel is called land-by-land pooling effects, which I will discuss this again when we talk about land-by-land population economies. The basic idea is that in a very dense labor market, there are many, many works looking for jobs. Also, there are many, many firms that are looking for workers. So in this case, we call the market, the labor market, dense or thick. In a thick labor market, since both the demand and the supply side, the quantity is very large. So it is more likely for a worker to find an ideal job. And also it's more likely for a firm to recruit skilled workers who meet their requirements. So the management quality will be higher. Another benefit in the dense labor markets is the so-called statistical economies. Because the labor market scale is very large, so by definition, if one worker gets laid off, it's more easy for this worker to find a job because there must be some other firms that have openings. Because when the market is very large, that relation between firms may be some firms will be their performance will be negative collapsed. Also some industry may be negative collapsed. So if one industry is growing, then another industry is declining. So unemployment from the declining industry may be easily find jobs in the growing industries. So basically the same logic can be applied to firms in the same industry. Think about the firms from many firms there. It's not always true that all the firms are growing. So some firms are declining, some firms are growing. So the labor turnover, if the labor turnover is very large, but the concentration of firms is pretty high, then it's very easy for people to find new jobs. In Silicon Valley, people have such kind of stories. Okay? The turnover is pretty high. So many computer engineers they change jobs, but they don't change the party notes because there are so many computer things there. And the third channel is so-called information or technology developers or knowledge developers. Sometimes we call human capital externalities. The basic idea is that when I work in a place where there are many other workers, especially when there are many other skilled smart workers. Then through all kinds of formal and informal social action, I can exchange the idea from them, with them. I can also learn new information from them. So basically, this creates more chance, more channels for me to learn from other people. This can be considered as a positive externality because when I talk to other people or when I observe other people, I learn something new, but I don't really pay them. So such kind of non-spillover effects is considered very important by macroeconomists. If you recall what you have learned in your advanced macroeconomics course, the endogenous growth models, many models they consider non-spillover effects in the country level is one of the driving forces of the long-term economic growth. The fourth channel is called specialization. Because localization economies emphasize the benefits from the concentration of the same industry firms like Silicon Valley. If we look at the cities with different scale, we have this observation. Big cities like New York, like Shanghai, Guangzhou, they host many different types of industries. But medium-sized cities, they're usually specialized. Like the examples are just in like a large specialized in oil industry, like Detroit specialized in automobile industries. Okay. So we are very familiar with Adam Smith's idea about land division in the story of the Penny Factory. So the specialization, if a city specialized in a certain industry, then the productivity of this particular industry will be higher simply because of the efficiency from that division across the city system. The last channel is server computation. I just asked the question, if you saw the computer firm, would you like to locate to Zumbach in Silicon Valley? Many people said yes. But the cost side is that since there are very many computer firms, if you choose to co-locate there, the computation will be very harsh. Then why do you still want to choose this location? There's some benefits associated with competition when you co-locate with the same industry firms. Okay. One benefit is that the competition will force you to speed up the innovation. Okay. Think about the food industry, the food transport city. Those restaurants that collaborate together, they can observe the new menus of other restaurants. They can observe how other competitors improve their services, and they can quickly adopt those new management skills and the new recipes probably. So basically, competition can promote innovation. So that's the basic idea. All these channels can be discussed in the static context, but also can be studied in a dynamic context. There is a very important paper by Harvard professor Glaser, published in 1992, DP paper. In this paper, they coined a new technology called the Martian Aero Robo Semantics. This guy did like this. The economist Marshall published his book called The Principles of Economics. There is one chapter he emphasized the benefits from the concentration of the same industry firms. And he argued that because the same industry firms co-located together, so the workers that have a lot of interaction, so they can learn from each other, so the whole industry can grow faster. Why? Even each firm has a constant of industry scale, but when these firms co-located together, because of these benefits, so each firm's productivity will be enhanced. So from long run, the whole industry will grow faster. So he discussed this dynamic positive externalities within his industry. That's why Glaser put a Marshall's name here. And Arrow has a paper about learning by doing. And Roman has a paper about how non-skill workers can promote the long-run economic growth. So he put the name together and called the dynamic localization economies the MARX. In the literature, sometimes we just call this dynamic externalities marshalling externalities or for organization economies, the concept is actually evolves all the time. In the first periods, in the early 1970s, 80s, many urban economists were trying to estimate the productivity benefits from large cities. So they believe that big cities can generate scale economies for all the industries. So basically, the benefit from the general level of the city scale, usually made by the city population, is called urbanization economies. And later in 1990s, economists discovered that not only city size matters, but also the industrial structure of each city is also very important. To be specific, economists consider that the diversity of the industry structure is very important. This concept, this idea is also emphasized in recent publications because of the influence of very famous urban scholar Jen James. Jen James is an urban scholar, she's not an economist. So she published a few books which are still very influential to urban economists. Her basic idea is that because big cities host a lot of different industries but also accommodate a lot of different people of different skills, so this cross-industry interaction actually can promote firms to invent new products. And she argues that for a city to grow, the city needs to have the ability to constantly invent new products and new industries. So basically, she emphasized the benefit of diversity. And the recent studies follow, actually already discovered James' idea. And those economists that construct theory models and also provide many empirical evidence to confirm James' idea. So this is why in this paper, the authors call the dynamic organization economies James' externalities. Because people believe the cross-industry spillover effects can promote innovation. Other micro foundations for urbanization economies actually parallel to the micro foundations of localization economies. Many inputs can be shared by different industries like infrastructure. The measure quality will also be high when a city hosts many different industries. Another particular point I want to make is that when the cities become larger, probably there are some benefits to produce different products. In economics, we call these benefits economies of scope. We are very familiar with the concept of economies of scale. So when we produce a lot of quantity of goods, the average cost will be high. And economies of scope means when a firm or a city produces many different kinds of products, then the average cost of each product will be lower. Okay? So if we see a city host many different types of industries, then it must be the case that it's more efficient to produce a broad set of different goods. about the business agglomeration economies, because we are focused on land-wide agglomeration economies, I just want to discuss business agglomeration economies. But if you are interested in this topic, these are the three articles you can use. Having said many things about business agglomeration economies, it's very easy to understand land-wide agglomeration economies because the concept is relatively parallel. So again, we can classify the benefits from the concentration of the workers in two types. One is called land-wide localization economies, another is land-wide organization economies. And parallelly, the localization economies means if I work in a city where there are many workers with the same occupation and the same industry like myself, then I can benefit from them. Suppose I'm a computer engineer, and then it's better for me to work in Silicon Valley. If I'm a finance major, it's better for me to work in Wall Street. It's easier for working in other cities specialized in different industries. The benefits from the concentration of workers in different industries is about the organization economies in land markets. Again, following Jim Tech's idea, in a dynamic context, we can also say that this benefit is called Jim's expansion in land markets. So basically, the concept parallel to the business agglomeration economies. I want to emphasize two things. The concept of the business agglomeration economies is intended to answer the question why do we have cities. But the land-wide agglomeration economies is meant to answer the question why do cities pay more? I think this is also a good question. Because the majority of the population live in cities, one benefit is that cities pay more. Okay? But there are many reasons why cities pay more. Very soon I will discuss the channels. For the time being, let's focus on what generates those benefits from the concentration of the economy in cities. We also use the same words like poor and learning, and also in other words, colonization. We don't discuss interest sharing because we are looking at the next price side, not the production side. So the labor market of poor effects basically it means in a very large, very thick labor markets, the metropolitan will be high between firms and workers, and also the search friction will be lower. It's more likely, more easy for unemployed workers to find jobs. For the learning effects, basically it's the same concept like the technological effects or information skills or human capital advantages. Because when workers co-locate together through formal and informal social interactions, they can exchange ideas. This is a very vague concept. In empirical studies, actually, we don't know how people interact with each other, actually. It's the black box. You can name a few channels, like people can communicate with each other through phone calls, through meetings in the restaurants. People can imitates other people's behavior. Also, through peer effects, which Professor Wilmer already discussed a few days ago, and also learning by doing. Later, I will discuss this is one of the ideas you can work on because we still don't have enough understanding how people interact with each other. I want to quote this paragraph from Thomas' paper to emphasize the intuition of non-zero effects. This paper is about long-run economic growth. And the author emphasized monetary only effects is one of the driving forces for the global economic growth. And he said that most of what we know, we learn from other people. We pay tradition to only a few of these teachers. But most of it we get for free and often in ways that are mutual without a distinction between students and teachers. And in urban economics, we emphasize monetary orders very much because this is one of the reasons why we have cities or why we want to live in cities. Even though the rapid development of information technology can reduce the cost of communication, but still, there are many things, many workers that buy face-to-face communication. So distance still matters. And the benefit of working in the big cities is that you can meet all kinds of people randomly or intentionally. You can learn from other people through different ways, and you can accumulate human capital, which will enhance the productivity. And in the competitive labor markets, the wages then will be higher. I think this idea is also very important for our daily life and also particularly for students. Those social interactions are so important. If you are very open-minded, if you are very relationship, so you always talk to people, pick up other people's brain, and also show other people your ideas, then it's really, really easy for you to come up with better ideas for your research. The third channel is the sort of networking, social capital. I think Mary discussed this on the first day. So basically, I followed the same definition by the sociologist. So social network is the people who you know, which can help you to get more resources. Mary already discussed strong ties means your family members, your relatives, your friends, classmates. And big ties means people you know but you are not very close to one of your family. In big cities, of course, you need more people, you establish more big ties. And the benefit of big ties is that people on your big tie that have different information than the information you have. So in terms of the benefit of exchange ideas, information, then META is more helpful. Okay. There are many studies try to estimate the magnitude of the labor market of Asian economies. Okay. The basic idea is that when workers co-located in big cities, they can benefit from each other. So they can accumulate human capital, they can enhance their skills, therefore they can improve their productivity, so the wage will be higher. So we can look at the wage data to see if workers receive high wages when they co-locate with other workers in the big cities. Alternatively, you can look at the other side, the labor markets, which is the production side. You can look at the food side to see when foods co-locate together, whether the productivity will be higher or not. But here we focus on the labor market. Now, many studies already show that when people work in big cities, the wages will be high. That's called a city size wage agreement or local wage agreement. There are two implications here. One is that compared with rural areas, urban workers receive high wages. The second implication is that compared with small cities, big cities offer high wages. Okay. Usually, people find this magnitude when the city size doubles, the average wage will increase by between 4 to 11%. This range may change depending on what the data, what kind of model you use. But overall, people really accept this static effect that things seem to have gone. I want to point out that one particular reference, this paper by Jan, it's a very nice paper, very simple and very clear, and it tests all the possible channels why six came on. The first channel would be simply because six is in big six the cost of living is high, so works ask for high rates to compensate for the high cost. In this general rate model, if you add city size to the right hand side, then you can estimate the city ratio, the local rate premium. Okay? But if you add the cost of living to the model, then the local rate premium should be reduced. The data on cost of living usually is the variable, so it's not hard to control for cost of living. And the second channel could be simply because high-skilled workers or more productive workers that select into big cities. I think Professor Donald also discussed this when he discussed the models on social interaction. People select into different groups, but if we define city as a big group, then high-skilled people may more likely to or moving to big cities. So if this is true, then what do we observe the positive correlation between city size and high wages? Maybe just because high school workers that live there. So the majority of empirical studies in this area actually tries to control for the big sources. It could be the case that firms in big cities are more productive because of the business of the corporation companies. So if I move from the rural area to the city, because the firms are more productive, so their productivity is also higher, so I can get higher wages. This is one of the benefits from the concentration of firms. But since we are looking at the labor market size, so usually in a wage model, we don't control for firm productivity. So if you use the firm data, you can easily test whether the firms in this list will have high productivity. The learning effect, on its own effect. This is the most important channel in the labor market. Many studies try to quantify the magnitude of this effect. In big cities, you need more people. You can also change jobs because you can find better information with the firm. So if you stay in the cities for 2 years, you can accumulate human capital, so the productivity is very high. And this human capital you accumulate actually is embodied with you. So when you leave the city, and even if you move back to the rural area, you still have the high productivity. So people use this identification to test the story human capital to compassion cities. Another channel is the economic point effects, or sometimes we call innovation or population. There are some recent papers that try to quantify the efficiency of innovation, but this is still a growing and a very new area. The best idea is to look at people who change jobs. If you change jobs more frequently in big cities, that means big cities offer opportunity to make better matches. And if you change jobs and you receive a higher salary than your previous job offers, then you can argue that the cities facilitate agglomeration. For this particular reference, I also used the panel data. That's an individual panel data for the National Longitudinal Survey to use the data track young people for many years. If you just use the simple OS model, then you can find the way to use is like the 19th state. So basically, in the big cities, part of the city size, the weight is really like 90% high. But after you control for cost of living and the weight is okay, then there are still one third of the benefits cannot be explained. Also the other test. So those one third of the benefits, like 6 or 7%, can be attributed to living and age. So basically, after control for cost of living and resourcing, there are still substantial local rate premium exist, which can be attributed to every market. Oh, city size. Okay, there are many ways to define city size. A simple way is using total population. You can also use total employment. It's endogenous in the sense that people will select, people will choose to certain type of cities to work and live. And we will discuss how to deal with this issue also. This is the important question in the whole of literature. In terms of localization columns of the so-called Martian landmark scientists, the evidence is very limited. Yeah. I had one study used the Boston population census data, and I find that in the Boston metropolitan area, if the if the percentage of the same occupation workers increase by 1%, then the individual wage on average rate increase by 0.17%. So basically, if I choose to work in a location where there are many same occupation people working there, then I can look for them and I used to study using the data. They found that if the same industry employment increases by 100%, then on average works rate increases by 3%. So they find the significant Martian nationalities in the Netherlands and markets. Another study from Italy, they found that basically they want to test the landmark pooling effects. They found that in dense landmarks or in big cities, landmark turnover is high, and also works receive more on the job trades. So basically, it means big cities, dense landmarks, facilitate job matching. This topic is still, in field study, as much in my scientist, and that is still very new. So if you can get some nice data sets, you can work on this area. But there are a lot of studies trying to quantify the benefits from human capitalized scientists. I just met a few. There is a very nice article by Moreshi, a good person. He summarized many empirical findings. Okay, one type of research found that in a city, if the average education increases by 1 year, then the average wage in the city increases by 3 to 5%. So, basically, most of the cities offer high wages. Another study shows that when the percentage of college educated workers in the city increased by 1% point, then the average rate will raise by 1%. This paper uses the US data. They found that in a small area, suppose I work in Jinan University, okay? Within these 5 miles, if I draw a unit surrounded by this campus, with 5 miles radius, then if the total number of skilled workers in this area increased by 1%, yes, because there is a law. Then my wage will increase by 4.5%. So basically, it means if I choose to work in a place where there are many other skilled workers, then over the long run, my productivity will be enhanced and my wage will be high because of learning from other skilled people. The good thing of urban economics is that we care about location, so we can see. Yes.
Could you go back to the previous slide, please?
Yes.
Isn't there a competing paper by Asamoglu and Angrist?
Oh, yes.
That finds something very different than what we already find?
Oh, right. So when you put the college share in the city to the wage model, usually we integrate the coefficients and the benefit from human capital expenditures. But that is another story. It could be high school workers and low school workers complementary. So in this case, we cannot say it's a pure human capital expenditures because some production may require both high school workers and low school workers to do together. Is this what you are pointing out?
I thought the Asamoglu and paper got a very small impact.
Oh, right, okay. In this article, yes, there are, yes. There are some studies that found little human capital expenditure.
There's the literature, I was one of the referees of the Moretti paper. And I was always puzzled by it because it never really convinced me. But the other referee and I made Moretti do 14 pages of sensitivity analyses between us, and his results didn't go away. But I've always been curious why it was that his result was so strong and positive, and these other papers that weren't doing particularly different things got null findings. Has the literature sorted that out?
I didn't check those literature. I will focus on the positive side because I'm a human economist. So I can't believe there is a human capital accident. Okay. This we care about location, so we can study the spatial distribution of economic activities. One last thing about the conversion economies is that we can see how such kind of benefits decay with distance. Why? Because such kind of benefits mainly comes from social interactions with other people. But when we live very far away with other people, then it will be costly for us to interact with other people. So in this case, distance increases the cost of social interaction. There are a few studies already found that the benefit from concentration of people and also firms actually decay in distance. One study using the good data found that firms benefit from the concentration of other firms, but certain benefits decay with distance. So basically, if I start a firm in Zhongguancun, I will benefit more from the firms in the Zhongguancun area, but not the groups in, let's say, in some area. In terms of that, like the agglomeration economies, many studies also found the decay effects. When I use the Boston data, I found that okay, here I need to explain a few terminologies in the literature. One is called block, another they call it block, another is called trait. Because many studies using the US data, they use these units. A block is simply like an independent theorem, like this theorem is what we want to see the block. A few blocks nearby is called a block group, and in the US Census Bureau, they define the block group as a few blocks nearby, but less than 10 blocks. And the whole campus can be considered a tract because it has a natural boundary. You use it as a wall. But for residential tracts, usually it has like on average 400 households, or maybe 8,000 population. So when I use the data, the block level data, because I know which block each worker worked. Okay. So suppose I work in this block, then I can benefit from the interaction with workers in the same area. But I can also socialize with people in other groups. Of course, I can also interact with people in the city. But it will be more costly for me to travel to those places. So I found that the benefit from skills, neighbors, colleagues, actually decay rapidly after 6 miles from this block. And this paper also found that the human capital externalities decay rapidly after 5 miles. So basically the distance still matters. If we look at the food side, there are many empirical studies trying to quantify the productivity benefit from concentration of foods. But the results, like the human capital externalities, the results are not in sense. But the majority in empirical studies did find the positive effects. One reason is that people use different measures on like a city size or industry diversity. But since we focus on that, I'm not going to go with this. So to summarize the empirical evidence, most of those studies that use data from developed countries like US, Canada, and European countries, most of them focus on city size region, less focus on the Martian nationalities. Most of them focus on urban workers because in developed countries, most majority of people live in cities. This leaves room for you to do research. For example, you can estimate the landmark of the agglomeration economies using data from developing countries. Countries in China, there is a large population living in cities, but there are rural migrants. One of my studies trying to quantify whether rural migrants can also benefit from everybody in the agglomeration economies in cities. You can also try to test other micro channels like landmark pooling effects. So now, suppose you want to do some kind of studies using micro level data, then you will face the challenges in terms of identifying the causal effects. Usually, if you have a cross sectional individual data, you can write down the simple wage model, which is standard. Suppose individual I works in city G, so where is the wage? Xi is the individual characteristics, and Ug is the variable structure measure, that might be conversion problems. You can put city size there, you can put the employment or employment density, whichever you prefer. You can also add average education in the city. You can also add current share. This is unobserved individual characteristics, unobserved city characteristics, and a pure random term. If you still remember the first Bloch's lecture, he mentioned, suppose this is a group, the city, a big group, then the empirical test involves two challenges. One is that's the unobserved group characteristics. Another is the unobserved individual characteristics. Since we focus on these coefficients, if these two terms is correlated with the city attributes, then the coefficients will be biased. So in the literature, many economists try to deal with these two challenges. I'm going to summarize some strategies to our inventions. But of course, you can bring your own new strategies. A natural consideration is to get an individual panel data, because if we assume the unobserved individual characteristics doesn't change over time, and if we have individual panel data, we can simply put the individual data there. The Glass paper, Sips and Scales, they used the individual physical model, and Yen's paper also used the individual physical model. So they found even though adding the individual fixed effects reduces the city weight equivalent amount, but still there are substantial weight equivalent on this plant. So another benefit for using panel data is that inside the panel data, usually you can observe people change jobs and also change location. So although the movers, if you can see a person change job from Guangzhou to Beijing, then you can see you can see control for unobserved individual characteristics, but also you have more variation in terms of the conversion variables. If you want to estimate the same model using good data, the strategy is pretty much the same. And if you track the firms, change the location, you can have better and the second strategy is to use the instrument variable. In the literature, they already found some convincing I really like this paper. So they put a city size here of total employment or income density. So it's one of the city characteristics. Since people may select into cities where there are more workers there, so in order to deal with this correlation, they use the percentage of land, which is not suitable, for human beings as an ID. The other way around it is they use the percentage of land area in that city, which is good for human beings. Why? Because this feature is given by nature. And of course, human beings, we want to live in a place where it's good for humans. Okay, it's correlated with city size or population, but it's not directly correlated with individual questions. So they used this idea and found a very significant city size weight equivalent. Another paper, they try to quantify the human health externalities, so they must be called share in the city as a measure. Again, people will also issue cities that's not most here. So the idea they use is to use the sort of language that presents the language one called in the city. I'm not very familiar with this institution, but it seems the company that actually established in 1862. So if in a city there was some kind of college, it was like 100 years ago. So they use this as an idea to force for each of the college share today. And they found the substitution of human capital as much as. Another simple way is just to use the long legacy size of college share as an idea. Suppose you have population system data back in the 1970s or maybe the past century. Then you can use the city size 50 years ago or 100 years ago as an idea. I also want to point out that when Professor James Quinn presented his paper, I think you can use his result as an idea. Suppose you want to estimate the rate of human diseases. Because he found that the number of people who become a few hundred years ago can explain the current average education in the city, right? So he already established this fact. So I think you can use his paper as an idea if you want to estimate city size, if you want to estimate human capital as amenities in China. This strategy is really the start of, and I'm not sure if I can clearly explain this. Suppose we have a cross section data. We know there are relations between the individual characteristics and city size, let's say. And we also know if we have individual fixed effects, then we can upgrade this relation. So what if you only have 1 year cross-section data? Actually, you can still do something. The basic idea is that we can construct many groups. For example, we put people with the same age, same gender, same occupation, maybe the same family size as one group. The basic idea is that when this group of people, they have so many things in common, it's likely that their unobserved characteristics are also similar. So through this way, you can construct many, many groups, and you put the group boundaries to the model. So it's kind of like an individual fixed effect, but the group, each group has at least more than two people. So that's the idea. Another idea is that if you want to study social interaction in a very small geographic level, like one of the paper this authors study, try to see if people living in the same block are more likely to work in the same block. I mean, here we have residential block and we also have workplace block. So the basic idea is that if we live in the same building, we see each other every day, so we exchange information. So when I'm for a job, I can get some information from you. So maybe you end up working in the same room. That's the basic idea. So here the group interaction is at block level. So if we can control for block group or trait characteristics, then conditional on people living the same trait or same block group, then the relation between unobserved characteristics and block characteristics may be very small. Simply because conditional on the block group or traits, there are not much choice when you decide to give a particular block. Think about this situation. Suppose you graduated from Beijing University and you're looking for a job. So first you want to choose a city. In China, we have like 600 cities. So there are a lot of selection, a lot of choice for you. But a condition on you want to work in Guangzhou, especially a condition on you're working in this district, there are not much choice you can make, right? So that's the best idea. But usually this strategy why you have very detailed micro-geographical information, and usually such data is confidential, so I think in many cases you can apply this method. Okay. Another method is try to find a proxy for unknown visibility. In every context, you have used in US, there is a test for ARM, the process verification test. So if you can use this test score to proxy for inevitability and inevitability required ARM to the time of the testing. Suppose you want to explain the wage model, you already include education variables there, but education is observability. Still, there are some ARM observability here, so if you have the test score information, and you can put the score in the model to proxy for ARM observability. Another strategy is to use the detailed geographical, detailed residential location as a proxy for ARM observability. The idea comes from residential sorting. This graph, actually the idea is already discussed by the president of Shihe. Okay? So he mentioned the residential segregation and also residential stratification. Okay? So the basic idea is that when people choose different neighborhoods and quality, they are based on some personal characteristics, really income, and also other articles and preferences or ability. So let's say XI is observed individual characteristics like education and gender and experience. And alpha R is observed individual ability or preference or taste. Okay? So beta XI plus alpha R jointly determines your expected income you can earn from the networking. So when people make residential location choice, they're based on the expected income. So these areas are residential neighborhoods. So the neighborhoods above, so the further away from the origin, the quality of the neighborhood is high. So basically this graph shows that high income people will choose to live in high quality neighborhoods. If there are many neighborhoods, if there are many people in a good sorting situation, then everyone will choose the particular neighborhoods based on the income interval. Okay. So in this case, we can basically use where you live to proxy for the observability. Okay, because condition on your observed characteristics, if you look at it, horizontally with fixed XI, then if you have higher armor visibility, then you will choose to higher quality neighborhoods. So this means we can use the residential location to proxy for armor visibility. So when we apply this methodology, we estimate the standard urban wage premium model. And we add a residential location fixed effect model. Here, because we can use the computation data, so we use the residential trend. So we create many values for each trend and add the trend value to the model. Then you can see the results. Okay, so our agglomeration variable is defined as employment density. If we just run the OS model, then the coefficient lambda is 0.24. If we add, Puma is an area where there are at least 100 some people. Okay. If in a place there are 200 some people, it will be classified as Puma. So basically, Puma is a big area. Just, so if we use Puma to define where you live, then from the coefficients in cheaper place. If we define your neighborhood as a difficult area, which is smaller than 2 miles, then the coefficient is still very similar. If we define your location as a tract, which is kind of like this campus, the coefficient is very stable. If we define the residential location even finer, use the same block or even block, then you can still get very similar results. So what does this mean? Because in the OS estimation, we care about the correlation between the individual ability and the city characteristics. Okay. However, when we cross for unobserved ability, we still found the similar effects. So basically, our study showed that the sorting across different cities, different workplace actually, is not a big problem when we estimate the random model. Another way to look at this strategy is that, well, usually it's reasonable to assume that the observability is highly correlated with unobservability. Okay? So if I know you have a PhD degree, I can guess your unobservability is also high. So if residential neighborhoods fixed effect can partially control for some unobservability, then when we add these variables to this model, then the coefficients of those observability variables should be smaller. So basically, we look at the coefficients of education variables. Usually, we have education variables like less than high school degree, college degree, and graduate degree. So when we add smaller residential neighborhood control, we do see that the coefficient of education variables become smaller and smaller. So we use this as evidence that residential neighborhoods fixed effect actually partially possible on observability. So the first time I want to give you a list of new topics. Some of them already done, but still a lot of room for improvement. Some of them are still new and no one has done. So maybe you can pick up some of them to look on if you are interested in this area. Okay. First, you can. You can try to think about if you can come up with better causal identification strategies. One way is to use the structure model. That's some of the economists that started to use the structure model. So if you are interested in this area, that is the silver article here. You can also use some basic product RDE. I'll put a simple example here. It may be not feasible, but just to give you this idea. So suppose you want to estimate the whole individual's benefit from life cycle size. You want to control for unobservability. Suppose you know the score of the college entrance exam for those people. And we know when you go to college, there is a special code. You need to have a score above that threshold to reach the college. So if you know the score and you choose people whose score is right above this cutoff and right below the cutoff, then since they have very similar score, you can assume that they have similar ability. But since they end up going to different college, so they end up working in the city. So if you compare these two people, you may use this silver lining method to identify the causal effects. Of course, we can also try to apply the regressive forces methodology. We have some of these available here. but I'm not sure how to use. The second topic is we have city size, we have population density, we have culture, this is very Australian. And the basic story is that people can interact with each other in cities. But actually, we don't know much about how people interact with other people in the real life. So we don't know the channel through which people socialize. There is one study by industry authors that used a survey data from France. The survey asks people how they communicate with each other in the workplace. So the survey asks the question of how people communicate within the firm, across the firm, and what kind of communication mediums they use, whether they use the phone, they use the email, or they use the fax machine, or they meet people in person. So this paper found that in big cities, they communicate more. And big cities, of course, we know office highways, and they are found that 13 to 20% of the effects of the more educated in our city. Basically, 13 and 20% of the city rate agreement comes from this communication channel. Okay. So the paper shows that it's because people communicate with other people. That is why there is super high rate. So I think this is the only study I'm aware of try to discover through this channel or in that with each other. This is also a very interesting topic, and it's about urban planners. Urban sprawl means cities expand in a way with very low density. So basically, cities become bigger, but the density becomes lower. That's called sprawl. When density is lower, then every person will have fewer neighbors to socialize. And also, people need to commute further to meet other people. So urban planners and other social sociologists argue that urban sprawl may reduce social connection, so it's a great thing. Jim Brooklyn is a very famous economist, but they have one study trying to see whether the sprawl really reduces social connection. They didn't find the negative effects, okay? But they do admit that they didn't deal with the main issue category. So the conclusion is it's a suggestion. So in the data, it's a super data. The super question I ask people how people socialize with other people. For example, the survey asked how often people talk or visit the neighbors. Yeah. And also the number of people. The number of close friends you have and how often do you socialize with friends. So the paper used these variables and the different variables. And on the right hand side, they use the population density in the residential trend to make you sprawl because low density means sprawl. So they didn't find the negative effect. Another interesting question is whether the development of internet communication really is reduce social connection. I asked the professor of this volume whether information technology reduces social connection. And he said it's both. It could increase social connection reduce social connection. Particularly, he mentioned that it increases interaction between people of the same groups. So think about how you socialize in the internet with public people. You are in the same group. So, but a lot of futurists they believe in the future maybe six will disappear because we can always have like a video conference to things lose enough. But for the economists, we still believe that face-to-face communication is still very important. Right? Otherwise, you would not have had this somewhere in school, right? You could just have a video on course. These gifts have all kinds of benefits. And the next question is whether these cities promote entrepreneurship, promote innovation. Okay? I have seen some studies using the payment data. One study found that in the US, when you invent a new patent, if you cite other patents, if you draw references from other patents, then you need to cite other patents. So usually the citation, the number of citations of the patents can be used to make a report of patents. Okay? One particular study showed that the patent citation is, a patent is more likely to be cited by inventors nearby. So basically, this means the knowledge global effect is very localized. Another study found that if you look at the patent data, you know the patent, you know the names of the inventors, but you also know the location of the inventors. So basically, they use the social network theory to estimate the effect of the social network of the inventors. They found that if you have close inventors in this, if you have close social network inventors in the same area, then you are more likely to produce more patents. Another study used the city of data they found that in high density cities in the US, the patent density is high. Patent density means the number of patents per less than 1,000 population in the city. So basically, all these findings means these cities can promote innovation. In China, we also have the patent data. It covers millions of individual patents. I haven't seen any people study how cities promote innovation using data in China. The data is publicly available, so I think you can try this study. Some people care about the benefits from network conversion economies for specific groups. One study found that in the US, CEOs also benefit from network conversion economies, especially for CEOs who change their jobs from big cities to small cities or from cities to rural areas. They still receive very high wages because when they stay in these cities for a long time, they can do better. Another strength of literature tries to quantify skills. So, in the US, there is a very nice data, the open data. So basically, this data creates hundreds of variables for each occupation based on scale requirements. For example, for salesperson, this occupation, it may require very strong communication skills. So that is the score for communication skills. For taxi drivers, that is a score for like a motor skills. So basically, for each occupation, there are maybe more than 100 occupation attributes, and each attribute has a score. So in a pretty competitive market, if workers can match the skill with the job very well, then we can safely assume if we observe you have a certain occupation, then you must have the certain skills required by this occupation. So if I observe your sales system, then I assume you have very strong skills. These authors have a series of papers that try to quantify the returns to skills. steels. And the steels is drawn from occupation attributes, because really the data observes people's passion. They found that volatility scale varies across cities, high wages, high wage premium for strong cognition and people skills. Peer people skills means social connection skills, communication skills. Sometimes we call this soft skills. But not for most skills, physical strengths. So taxi drivers, they have strong skills, but they cannot get much wage premium in big cities. Communication skills, we see high premium in big cities. Unfortunately, in China, we don't have a very good classification on education. So, maybe we can figure out a way how to make the decision of pin codes with pin codes in this data set. So far, we talked a lot about the benefits from the concentration of people and workers. So the question is, since cities offer so much benefits, why don't all the people move in the cities? So what you call there are some costs associated with the buildings in cities. So one cost is high housing price. So if you think about the spatial equipment, suppose people can move freely across all the cities, then since the land supply of each city is limited, if more people move to this city, then the housing price will be generally high, so which will prevent more people moving to these cities. So usually, when you look at the land market, when you look at the urban land markets, you cannot ignore the housing markets. So in equilibrium, people will receive the same utility no matter where you work, no matter where you live. So if you are interested in structural modeling, then you can look at the spatial equilibrium concepts and try to write the structural modeling and estimate the housing markets and land markets generally. Finally, I want to mention the land market information is very conscious, particularly in China. The urban land markets in China is very different from developed countries because we have a lot of restrictions on land mobility. We also have a lot of restrictions on city development. The government restricts the development of large cities. We have the focal system on restricting people to move freely. These barriers may prevent the cities to offer the benefits, and also it may prevent people to gain the benefits. There are very, very few studies on the conversion policy in Chinese cities. This paper it's a well-cited paper found that the Chinese cities, many Chinese cities are too small. So that means there is a huge potential for the Chinese cities to offer more the conversion benefits. So I think and what it is, but it's time for break because for the rest of time I want to present one or two of my study suggestions. I want to give you a brief introduction of one study at by the head of the conversion economies in the US cities. I want to summarize the conversion. There are already many studies confirmed that there exists in that market, the commercial economies in the US cities. And also, there is a large literature documenting the great white wage gap. And we try to link these two together we found that less, here I mean, agglomeration benefit much less from the agglomeration economies in the urban markets compared with size. We try to explain why this is so. We present one piece of evidence to show that it's probably because black workers, the length of the same place appears, same place still appears in the workplace. So basically, the benefit from labor market, the globalization economy is run through the racial specific channel. So if blacks interact with only blacks, probably this will prevent them to reap the full benefit. We also use the firm data to double check whether firms benefit less if this firm's racial composition is very different from the racial composition in the surrounding environment. And we also present some suggestive evidence to show that blacks, they feel much greater social distance from whites, even they work in a place where their colleagues are all whites. So basically, this social distance, we can say this discrimination, it could be just because the preference that people want to socialize with other people who come from the same ethnicity as them. But from the data, we usually see that even a black worker works in a purely white firms, they still cannot so that they still feel large competition from their colleagues. So we use the US census data. The long form data is confidential data, so we know the information where each worker works, including which block they work. Also, we know which block they live. We also use the manufacturing census data and use the general service data. In China, we have a general service. The CGS data. So the CGS has got a really similar to the CGS data. We are very familiar with this model. So this is the same wage equation. The mechanism is individual wage, individual characteristics like that. And in CG, we use the income density and college share to measure the level of the this is an algorithm with individual activity. We know that there will be a sorting problem for a few people who are more likely to sort into cities with high income density or high quality share. So we use the same strategy, we use the residential check for individual activities. This is a baseline model. Here we didn't include the census data, but we included the result of this, we understand that we see very significant margin, that might pull effect, and also human capital expenditures. When we estimate the model by races, we see that although, on average, all the people can benefit from that market economies, but black workers can benefit like that. Just one third, okay, they can get only one third of the benefits as blacks. And this is the same for human capital energies. For other minorities, they also benefit less, but not so much less. There is a debate whether we should compare other minorities with whites, but it seems to be good literature about wildlife wetland and also about vegetation irrigation is it about wetland and whites. So we just focus on the difference between wetland and whites. In order to test whether this less benefits that we see is due to other factors like that, whether blacks and ivory they have low education, whether they live in a neighborhood which is segregated, or whether they don't have much access to job opportunities. We use that very simple approach. In the early solution, we have a more reasonable model, okay, but the police suggest us just use a very simple approach. So basically, we interact the language programming variables with all kinds of other determinants. All other possible weighted determinants. Here we include individual characteristics. We also include the city-fixed dependencies. Here city is defined as an important element. We also include the occupation and industry. So basically, we allow the benefits from nevermind agglomeration economies to vary in many dimensions. The benefit can vary by race, by education, can vary by which city you live, can vary by population and industry. We try to see after we control for so many factors, if the blank coefficient is still negative. We also add the residential fixed effect to cross for other compositions. This table shows you the fully interacting model. So basically, we interact the employment density and copy share in the workplace with all the variables. As you can see, for the benefit from total employment density, many variables are not significant. The only significant coefficients are the black coefficients. African American, basically black and also for masculine unity. So after we control a lot of factors, it still shows that black workers depend much less from employment density. And this negative effect is as important as the masculine image. If you want to compare the magnitudes. In terms of human health as managers, although other variables are also important, like if a person has a better education, this will help the worker get more benefit from human health as managers. But still, being black is going to seem much less benefit. Theoretically, we can control for age, but we use the observation of the equipment and measure. So basically, we classify workers in different groups based on age and education and family status and education. So we create many groups. These groups kind of like individual businesses. And we combine these groups with the residential trade. So basically, we try to use this approach to classify people into many, many, many small groups. And we use the group dynamics to control the harmony of the sensitivity. Later, I'm going to show you if we don't do this. Comes to your question. Okay? So if we only include the metropolitan area as your residential location. The black coefficient is your negative. Here, I didn't put the split level here, but all of them for the black coefficients, all of them are significant. If we add the excess transfix effects, because it's better control for animals in the DDT, so we see the regulation, the coefficients. We use the more smaller residential neighborhoods, still coefficient is stable. This trap cell is the trap fixed effect plus those demographic group fixed effects. So this control for more animals in the DDT. So basically, no matter how we control for animals in the DDT, we still get the same negative effects for plants. The same for the return to happens. So you may argue that it could be because blacks that concentrate in central cities, many of the central cities are deteriorating. So this prevents black people except jobs. So this is so-called spatial mismatch hypothesis. Many black workers that live and work in the central city, but many jobs are concentrated in some area. So because blacks, they on average, they have no education, no income, they cannot afford a car. So maybe they're also discriminating in the housing market, so they cannot accept jobs in the south. Is it because blacks that concentrate in some particular neighborhoods, so they only socialize with blacks, so they cannot get better job information? It could be because in the workplace, the blacks work, the job density is lower. It could be because most of the blacks take public transit instead of driving by car. It could be because blacks work in industries which has no stable effects. So we did all kinds of some splits and we still find the same negative effects for black. So we can exclude this interpretation like harm with ability for blacks, especially with the hypothesis with advantageous segregation. So the only interpretation we cannot exclude is actually drawn from some recent literature. So this research found that blacks that are it's very hard for them to accept jobs in their workplace. It's not because they are discriminated, probably. It's because there are not enough black jobs for them. And basically, it's not because there are not enough jobs in the workplace. It's because there are not enough jobs for blacks. So, blacks suggests that to increase the job accessibility for black workers, probably it's better to create more jobs for black workers. Why is this? Maybe because black workers, they get job information from black workers. Maybe they socialize with the same black peers here. Okay. So we get the idea from this literature, we hypothesize that social interaction may be race-specific. I think this is reasonable based on my experience in the US. So we do see Chinese people that socialize with Chinese people, that you network with many Chinese people. We buy food, we eat in the Changchun town. Okay, so, the same thing happened for other ethnicities. So in order to test this hypothesis, in the sensor data, we don't have a good measure for social network. We don't know how people socialize with other people. So we just simply add a variable called the overall based employment share in the workplace. So basically for each workplace, we calculate the proportion of works who are the same, who are in the same place. We also kept the same variable for quality share. So basically, it's the, in the workplace, the share the quality workers who are from the same race. Okay? And we added in the variables to the model. And now you see a big change. Okay? It's reasonable that these two own race variables are very different and very important because if people do surplus, we have some people. But what's interesting is that the black coefficients, it becomes not negative anymore. So what does this suggest? Okay. It could be because being a black work, if there are many other black peers in the workplace, then I can still get the benefits from the concentration of skilled workers in the same race. But not, I can't get much benefit from the concentration of other people from other races. So this could be because the social interaction is very specific. And we did a lot of the Boston check and we still find the same pattern. These results are from the labor markets. That is some theory about the bargaining power. So if I were a black work and in the workplace there are many other black workers, so suppose we have a trade union, then we will have a high, strong bargaining power with the employer. So we are more able to see the advantages. In order to exclude such kind of hypothesis, we try to look at the firm side. So we use the firm data, it's the prompt level data. So the prompt level data, we know the inputs of each firm, we can calculate the variables. But in the firm data, we don't know the work composition. So what we did is to follow other literature. We know the ages of each prompt. So basically, we know the trend of each firm. Then we match the location with the population census data. We aggregate the location at the three-digit industry zip code level. A zip code is an area depends on population density. Sometimes it's smaller than the trend, but sometimes it's bigger than the trend. Yes. We assume firms in a zip code in the same three-digit industry is one big firm. Because for this three-digit industry zip code cell, we can match the population census data. We can count how many black works, white works in this cell. Basically, for each industry cell, we know the racial composition of the workers. We know the education composition of people in this cell. For firms in this cell, we assume they have the same racial and education composition. Because there is no way to match the basically, this is what we did follow the literature. People have used this methodology to estimate how firms can benefit from the concentration of quality shares in the workplace. They also use the same approach. So through this approach, for each firm, we can know the employment density and also quality share in this cell. And we also know the racial composition, the percentage of whites, blacks, Asians in each cell. Then I define the workplace at the Puma level. The Puma is an area bigger than tracks. It contains at least 100,000 people. Then we create an index. It's a little bit tricky for the index, but the basic idea is that we have the ratio shares for each plant, basically the ratio share in each industry in Brazil. And we also know the ratio share in the Puma from the sense data. Okay. So we constructed this index. The basic idea is this. Conditional on the ratio composition in the big phase, okay? If the own ratio share in my firm is higher, then we want to see if the productivity is higher. So the basic idea is this. Okay. Suppose in this big neighborhood, there is a 50% black workers. Okay. For this individual firm, if the black share is like 10% versus 60%, we want to see how this change in productivity. We estimate a standard transfer production function.
I don't understand exactly why are you multiplying there.
Okay.
So I.
Oh, they can be the sum.
What?
Okay. Okay. For each place, I calculate the two shares and then I give the sum. So basically, conditional on the neighborhood ratio composition, I want to see if this plant is over ratio. If this firm's ratio is higher, will this increase the productivity?
So I see that, but why are you multiplying by the ratio in the Puma? I would have thought you almost wanted to divide by it. You want to see whether I'm high. I would have thought you want to see whether I'm high in this firm relative to the rest of the city.
Relative to the rest of the city. Basically, do not.
But that would be dividing, not multiplying.
We could have considered other measures, but we only use this one because the idea is just to see condition of the environment. If the particular ratio is high for this group, we try to see the effects. There is a disadvantage of using the sensor data, the computational sensor data, is very hard to come back. We will see a lot of feedbacks, but it seems it's very hard to come back to improve the situation.
I mean, can you give an example? Like, when would this be? Can example why this, when this index would be high, and example when it would be low?
We don't measure in this way. The simple idea is to controlling for the ratio position in the environment. If the particular ratio share of the firm is higher or is lower, then you want to see the effect. Because if it's lower, it means the risk composition doesn't match with the environment. But if it's higher and we see a positive effect, that means you can say it's higher. Suppose the urban waste share is the same as the waste share in the environment. That's the benchmark, because that's the good dimension. So if my owner's share is lower, and we find a negative effect, then it means because this firm's ratio position is different from the environment, so this may prevent social reaction. So in the extreme case, if the owner's share is much higher than and if you think about offices, then the owner's share is much higher than the environment. So when we add this owner's share, we call this index the owner's share exposure. then we interact with the income density and the body share. We found that this interaction is very significant positive. So basically it means to enjoy the benefit from the conversion, then it's better for this firm's ratio to match the ratio position in the environment. Actually, it's better if my old owner's share.
So is this saying segregated firms are better?
No, the segregated firm is worse.
Is worse.
Yes, but this is also based on the aggregate level. It's not the particular firm. It's many firms in the zip code and in the same industry. So this result also very robust if we do robust and change. So the basic idea is, Chris mentioned, if a firm is segregated, the racial position is very different from the racial position in the surrounding environments, then the firm will receive lower productivity benefits. But if the racial position matches and even, above the surrounding environment, then the firm will get some benefits from the CO. I think if a firm's own risk share is to borrow the smart aggregate. So the last aggregate we provided is this is about the cost check when we split the industry into something like a high scale industry and low scale industry. For example, we split the industry by the R&D activities and also by the patent intensity. So as you can see, for firms in the industry with a higher R&D activities or with a higher patent activities, only scalability effects is more important. So the last piece of evidence is we use the general social survey data to see whether play works there. A distance from other ethnicities. So in the data, the survey only asked the questions for whites, but not for blacks, but not for other minorities. So we can only check how the blacks feel about socializing with whites. So. This column, the left-hand side of is the evidence what the government has for blacks. So it's an ordinal variable, much. One is too little, three is too much. Of course, for blacks, they feel the government help for blacks so that the government needs to have more for blacks. It was a cohesion. This doesn't relate to the percentage of whites in the place. these critical measures that were this is the post-treatment duration of the damage. So the boys are less likely to achieve the post-duration of the damage. Again, you come to the isn't it wise and interest? This variable asks us how close this person is to X. One is not at all, nine is very close. So of course, blacks feel more close to blacks. It's really bad. So at this point. Okay, so if a black works in a high percentage of white school blacks, then they feel less close to blacks. I think this is also useful because when you have a lot of white colleagues there, you socialize, you also socialize with whites, you index with them, probably you become more open-minded and more tolerant. What is the relationship? Okay. So suppose one black worker works in a place with like same with whites, okay? Close to one. This black would still feel closer to X. Okay. That's the relationship. So no matter how many white colleagues you have, you still feel closer to X. Close to whites is the opposite of this model. You see the coefficients here, blacks feel less close to whites. And this is the so basically, this shows that, of course, blacks feel close to blacks, but even this black worker works in a white dominant workplace, this black will still feel close to blacks. This probably suggests that there is a social distance between people from different races. So this is what we have done to show that the benefits from aggregated machine comes may run from the channel that is less specific. So another study I haven't finished yet, it's already in progress. We try to see whether in the Chinese land market, that exist the aggregated machine comes. And if so, the good or bad is going to be wrong. The reason we have a good or bad is because for at least two reasons. One reason is that the Chinese cities are growing, but part of the population growth is from good or bad goods. And the majority of good or bad goods are low skilled. Or average below the average almost 98% of people are migrants receive the education below high school. In this very competitive globalization, it's very important for cities to be able to scale out. But when we look at the Chinese cities, we have more people. So the question is, how can we make the cities scale? So this is an important policy question. And secondly, that the manufacturing industry in Chinese cities, especially in the coastal cities, are moving back to the inland. So the remaining manufacturing industry in the coastal cities, they should be upgraded. But we know during the past few decades, the growing manufacturing industries, mainly because of the lower level cost. So the upgrading of the manufacturing industry will be needed many high school workers, but we still have certain migrants that still working in the manufacturing industries. How can we make them scaled? The Chinese governments are making some, they are doing something to help those workers. One policy is to send them back to local vocational schools, they can receive trends and the traditional grades. But it seems the government cannot send all the rural migrants back to schools. So if people can learn from formal and informal social interaction in the urban labor markets, maybe this could be a channel of what we call to accumulate human capital to enhance the skills. So this is the motivation we need to study. Parallel to the previous study, we used both the population system data and the manufacturing system data. The reason we use the manufacturing system data is because for this particular year, the survey covers all the manufacturing firms in the cities. So basically, we can calculate precisely the total employment and the cost share in each industry in each city. From the population census data, we only have a random sample of the population census data. We know which industry a person is working and we know the city. So we create a city industry cell and we link these two data sets together. So basically for each worker in the census data, we know the total employment and the quality share in the industry city cell. So basically, we made the margin expenses because the conversion rate was described as the city industry level. And the reason we did this is that because we only have the cross section data, we try to avoid the sorting. Okay. So we try to avoid the sorting across cities because if we define the total employment and credit share at the city industry level, we can control for city fixed rates. We can also control for industry fixed rates. So we basically remove all the sorting across cities and industries. Of course, for a particular worker, given this person working in this city, there might be still some sorting across industries. But we cannot So our key application comes from the degradation of the information variables and the city industry as well. We also added our application targets, probably our strategy for this variable. We know application targets can be used to post for skills. Since we cannot control for one of the skills, we just simply have application. Suppose application dynamics can be controlled for part of the one of the skills, then we should see the conditions of the education variables become smaller. So I just want to focus on this particular column. So here we have the last column. We have the application boundary, we have the industry boundary, we have city events. So we see a very strong significant human capital expanding effects. We don't see much regular reporting effects on average. This result uses the force sample. We did some robustness checks. For example, we choose a sample. With workers who are local. When I say local, which means these workers stay in the city and they never moved. So there is no sorting across cities. So we do see a similar human capital assembly effects. For migrants, because they move around, you do see eyes. So, but overall, that is the most evidence for human capital expenditures in Chinese cities. And it's more interesting, this estimate coefficient actually is pretty much in line with the literature using the US data. So, because we care about the rural migrants, so I see an estimate model for rural migrants. So, this is the results. You see rural migrants. sort of items that benefit from both types, never mind the machine economies. No matter what kind of flow wasn't checked, do you, we do see the benefit from both types of machine deregulation economies. Then I compared from items with three other types of people. I classify people based on the urban and rural people, based on whether the local items. We only need to look at the last column. So the default category is the local urban residents, like people living in Guangzhou, but also have a good local. That's the default category. Then I have the urban migrants, people have the basic local, but they are working in Guangzhou. Then I have the local rural workers, local farmers here. Then I have the rural migrants. Added these values to the model, and I also interact them with total employment and also college sharing. So this is the interaction term we care about. What we call the default is the local urban residents. Compared with local urban residents, rural migrants that benefit much less from the network point rate. Compared with local urban residents, rural migrants benefit much less from human capital expenditures. Note, I have added the values. Rural migrants and migrant urban. So if we add up all the coefficients together, overall rural migrants still enjoy benefits. That's the results from the previous slides. It's it's after we added the election term, we see rural migrants benefit much less. So how should you explain the results? You might have many different types of expression. It's clearly because of rural migrants, because they are unskilled, they are not smart enough, so they cannot learn much from their peers. It could be because they work in informal job sectors, so they generate skills for themselves. It could be because they lack of social network, because they only socialize with rural migrants. It could be because of discrimination. We can exclude the first two interpretation, but we can have a few more tests for the other two. When we look at the low school and high school sample, for high school worker, I used the sample high school worker, basically they received college education or above. Given the interaction model, as you see, even for high school worker, if you are rural migrants, so you might have experience in high school workers are rural migrants. But one good example is one of the fellow members in this institute. He got a PhD from Australia, but his focus is rural or Guangzhou. So in our sample, he is considered rural migrants, but high skilled. So even for high school worker, if you are rural migrants, you receive much less than it's compared with local rural residents. You also receive much less benefit from skill effects, but I mean the magnitude is sizable, it's not a very significant. For low skilled workers, again, the benefit much less. So this is not a story about whether you are high skilled or low skilled. It's because you are whether you have the rural local or not. It's because whether you are local or migrants or mayors. So basically, the rural migrants that enjoy much less benefit because they're because they are rural and because they are migrants. We cannot test whether this is due to very limited social network they have, provider that discriminate in the internet markets. But based on anecdotal evidence and also government and news reports, show that it's full of migrants.
Isn't another story just exposure? So, I mean, if it's a human capital externality and I learn from my social network, if I've been interacting with my social network for 10 years, I've learned a lot. But if I'm a migrant and I just showed up yesterday, I haven't had the exposure. So maybe, so it seems like you might want to correct for how long you've lived in the city.
Oh, okay. That's a good idea. We haven't checked it.
Because literally, I mean, it's a human capital externality. I shouldn't get it the day that I show up.
Yeah, okay. So we, so you suggest we add another how
many years are there? And the interaction between that might be really interesting. So you might see that they get nothing when they first get there, but then it goes up the longer time they've been there.
Yeah, this is an idea. Okay. So, one story I can tell from an urban ecologist in Shanghai. So he received his PhD from Europe.
What?
And he got a Shanghai Hukou in the Fudan
University.
So one day he wanted to apply the credit card in the bank. And the bank rejected his application because the first stenographer with his ID. Is 301. Why? 301 is the ID number for people who were born in Shanghai. But simply because he was not born in Shanghai, he cannot get a credit card in the bank. So that's the discrimination for migrants. So unfortunately, we cannot do more tests. So we only have the tentative inclusion of human migrants in the one part of what we are doing is that we try to use the China general social survey data to see if rural migrants are indeed discriminated in the workplace. For example, how do they socialize with other people in the workplace, whether they receive less chance to be promoted. So we are still working on this part of the announcement. So I guess I have to stop here. This is what I have prepared. So we spend some time, so let's give the time for